Hello, I'm Jack Rickard. This is EVTV. I'm here with my consigliere and compadre, El Brain Noto.
Hey, it's good to be here.
What do you know, Brain?
Well, it is Friday. This must be the Friday show. It's not quite as cool as last week, but not as bad as it was for about a month, so...
Friday the 19th of August.
Friday the 19th of August.
2001, a year of our Lord. Do you have any stimulating and exciting electric vehicle news to titillate our senses with here?
Well, I'm not going to make that this is going to be a new segment here that I'm going to do, but I brought in a little saying today.
A saying?
I thought we'd work in, yeah, I thought was kind of funny. It goes like this. Some people are like slinkies. Mm-hmm. They have no apparent purpose, but you smile when you push them down the stairs.
I see. No apparent purpose, but they bring a grin when you shove them down the stairs.
I kind of like
that. I like that.
I do, too. I thought we'd bring a little levity in here.
Put that on a T-shirt or something.
I think so, huh? With the EVTV logo.
Yeah.
Other than our other famous saying, paint it black, it'll disappear. Let's see. Well, we do have a confirmation of one of the vehicles that's going to be here for our drag race.
Okay, very good.
And that is the, and we may be able to put up a little link or something to a shot. I think we've got a shot of it going down the drag strip.
Okay.
Making this run. It's a Ron Adamowitz of the East Coast Electric Drag Racing Association.
He's the El Jefe there, isn't he?
He is the El Jefe of the association. He's got a full-bodied 1981 Chevy Camaro that he just turned a quarter mile in 10.08 seconds, and I think about 127 miles an hour. Yeah, 127 miles an hour. So that's
10.8 or 10.08?
10.08. 10.08. So he's getting close to cracking the.
I see why he was wanting me to put up that $2,500
purse. Well, he's confirmed.
Well, I guess we're paying him.
I guess that Ron's going to bring it. So that should be quite a treat for all our attendees and the spectators that come from the local communities to see a relatively silent, tire-smoking, full-bodied, purpose-built Chevrolet Camaro hauling ass down the drag strip.
We'll see how Dwayne's 904 does against him.
And there you go. You know, we've talked about how in primarily the UK, you know, in Europe for the most part, but the UK especially, there are literally hundreds of boutique car manufacturers out there making, not particularly kit cars, but making, you know, hand-built 100 cars, 20 cars a year. Morgan
would be the granddaddy
which
of
is
that
really,
thing. How long have they been making cars?
Oh, my God. You know, I don't know if it says here, but it's been...
It's probably 40 or 50 years.
Probably. Morgan's probably since World War II, after the war, I bet they've been making cars. Mm-hmm. But not very many. No. I mean, they're literally maybe, 100 a year
or
something?
Yeah, a couple hundred cars.
Yeah, not many at all. But they're going to do a prototype of an electric vehicle. They're going to use a manual transmission. They're going to use... instead of their... a BMW power plant that they normally put in there, and lithium-ion batteries, and so I think it'll be kind of cool. But Morgan, that's one prototype that I would really like to see, and hopefully see it come to fruition at any price. I think that'd be a really cool car.
Maybe we'll get him to the show next year.
Maybe we can get him to the show next year, exactly. But that's it. It was slim pickings on my end here. Just want to let you guys know what was going on with the race and give
you a little something. We've got some interesting stuff here.
Okay.
The World Watch Institute. Now, I understand this is kind of a sustainable energy World Watch Institute.
Oh, okay.
It's not entirely unbiased, but it's pretty good numbers. in a report from a sustainable energy fellow, Saya Kitase, and his co-researcher, Natalie Narotsky. They're claiming that we've hit a new high in the production of oil. Okay. That 2010, after a 1.5% decrease during the financial
people just weren't buying
fiasco,
as much gas and things.
That we recovered very nicely in 2010 with a 3.1% increase in total oil production for the year. And we hit an all-time high ever of 87.4 million barrels of oil consumed per day.
And that's a worldwide number?
Yes,
wow.
It is.
That's amazing.
One-third of the increase came from China.
And that's what we've been talking about, that whole middle class coming out of the Asian powers. Yeah.
They now use over 10% of the world's oil.
Oh, man.
And I take that little bit of information, and this is where I get a lot of stuff, is take one little bit and put it with another little bit, mm-hmm. and it turns into something kind of interesting. China's vehicle count increased in 2010 27.5%.
Wow. That's amazing.
They now have 78 million vehicles. Now, we are at about 240 million registered in the U.S. We have a vehicle for each 1.3 people.
Yeah, they're not even close to that.
They have, right now, 17 people per car.
That's now, a hell of a carpool.
It is quite a carpool. You've really got to pack them in.
Last time I saw that was the Shriner guys trying to get in and out of the little Volkswagen.
There's a couple of things that strike me immediately. One is we get the Chinese batteries, of course. Mm-hmm. So we think electric, and they have Chinese buses, electric buses, mm-hmm. and some electric taxis.
Yeah.
So we think that China is going to be big into electric vehicles.
Yeah. I mean, that's what it would look like, yeah.
Guess what?
What?
They've put a huge incentive on electric vehicles last year, and they didn't sell any.
Really?
Almost none.
Uh-oh. Now, why would petrol power?
Why would that be?
Cost?
You know, some funny things happen in a leap into the 21st century. For example, China and India and a number of places never did develop our landline telephone infrastructure that we enjoyed here in the U.S.
Yeah, you're
but
right.
With the advent of the cell phone, they could kind of skip over
they jumped
put up
right
some
to
cell
wireless,
tower,
yeah.
and skip the whole wiring
yeah.
gig.
And save a lot of money, get it up quick, yeah.
They have developed a taste for automobiles in China. Mm-hmm. They're up to 78 million of them now. Guess what they didn't develop along the way?
Electrical power everywhere?
No, they've got electrical power pretty well.
I wonder what they didn't get. Gas stations?
They have plenty of gas stations. They don't have any garages, Brian. They all live in high-rise apartments because they are accustomed to getting around by bicycle.
Bicycle and a bus.
And so everything is centralized in these cities, and they've built up in enormous high-rises. They don't have a garage for their car.
They don't have a garage for the car. And yeah, what kind of extension cord would you run from your apartment? That'd be 300 feet long.
Straight down.
Yeah, straight down. Oh, no.
Electric cars aren't going to take off in China unless they completely redesign the way they live.
Yeah. Oh man.
They have bicycles that they can put in the elevator and take into the apartment.
Mm-hmm.
You can't do that with a car.
No, it'd be very small. Yeah.
So they have to park it somewhere else. Take the bicycle to where their
car is. Yeah. 2 miles to your car. Yeah, a different world.
Here's the other thing that strikes me. We have 307 million people. They have 1.331 billion, they think.
Yeah, they're probably not sure. That would be a lot of cars if just 10% of the people got them.
They have four times our population.
Yeah.
China has 20 million vehicles. I mean, India has 20 million vehicles, 56 people per car,
ooh.
With a population of 1.155 billion.
Man. I can't see where the price of oil is headed.
It's
oh man,
I don't know. I should probably diagram this out at some point. But all eyes are on the wrong place. The production of oil, the amount of oil reserves, which they're now claiming is 1,526 billion barrels.
In reserves, okay.
In reserves, okay. Including all the liar's poker going on in OPEC.
Right, right. Yeah, they're not telling anybody.
We're up to producing 87.5 million barrels per day.
That's amazing.
And the demand for automobiles is growing, and the biggest growth factor in getting them, I don't think, can use electric cars, even if they can produce them, which they can.
Which they can.
They're going to produce them and sell them here.
Here and in
but
Europe.
They're not going to have a market for them because of the large percentage of the middle class population that would want a car in China, living in high-rise apartments without garage facilities.
Yeah, just logistically, you just can't do it.
It's And so they had this incentive last year for electric cars, and no takers.
Yeah, that makes sense. Wow.
So we're headed for an increasing number of gasoline-burning cars in the world. Now, understand, it took till 1995 to reach 500 million cars globally in operation.
Okay.
95 years. It took another 15 years to double that.
Man, that's exponential growth. It just doesn't sound like it's going to stop.
Well, the thing about exponential growth is that means in another 15 years or 2025, we would likely be at 2 billion.
2 billion, yeah. Wow. Isn't that amazing?
Except it's accelerating.
Yeah.
It could happen before that.
Yeah. Wow.
Now, while all of you are focused on oil and where they're going to find oil and how much oil there is, it doesn't matter. With that growth in the number of cars, you're going to face a huge increase in fuel costs.
Yeah, it's
going
to have to be. Yeah.
And right now, about a third of our energy, 37% of our energy worldwide, comes from oil.
Comes from oil. Wow.
So not just for cars.
Right.
And so we're headed for a bad hair day on this. And it's not so much that they can't produce more oil or that they can. It's simply an exponential rise in the number of automobiles and the demand for oil.
Right. Yeah, and how would you keep up with that demand? If you could even build oil fields and refineries fast enough, you couldn't.
Now, everybody thinks I'm tilting at windmills. We're going to solve this problem by me getting on TV and telling you to go to your garage and sweep out of space and build an electric car. Tee-hee-hee-hee. The advantage I've got is it's my second rodeo, and I know how things really happen. And you cannot convince people. But there is an interesting study out now.
Okay.
Rensselaer Polytechnic did it under commission from the United States Army and the United States Navy.
Okay.
And they're interested in things like the uprising in Egypt and in Libya.
All that political unrest.
Yeah, why?
What fomented that, yeah.
Why does someone like Muammar Gaddafi stay in power for 30 or 40 years and then all of a sudden doesn't?
I don't know. It's an interesting question.
Well, and it's the question they've asked. They've developed some computer simulations and did some studying on it, and they found a remarkable number that they and I call a tipping point, and that is if you have a population that has sort of a random set of beliefs, and you have a subset of it that has a fairly focused set of beliefs, that believes a particular thing, at what point does it become adopted?
It goes
over the tipping point, adopted by the body politic.
Mm-hmm.
And they found a very sharp tipping point at about 10%.
So if 10% have a very kind of a viral type of belief, then it
if 10% believe up is down, yeah. And when you go over 10%, you it go is. Immediately to 90%.
Yeah, amazing.
Almost overnight.
Wow. I remember that movie when I was in like second grade, the lemmings that would jump off of the jump off the cliff. All it took was one to go.
The way the human organization works is that most people don't have a passion in any particular direction.
Yeah.
The notions of our political gridlock are sort of vague. A Republican, we should have less government and less taxation. And mm-hmm. Democrats, that we should have more government and more taxation and solve all these things.
Yeah, yeah. If it's even and, that cut and dried, yeah, yeah.
And, I mean, that's yeah, that's broadly kinda, it.
Right.
On any particular topic, there's a great deal of mixing of body fluids.
Right, right.
The Republicans are convinced we should do something about all these illegal Mexicans. I think the solution to our budget deficit and the Social Security thing is we need at least 60 million more Mexican immigrants.
Could use a little tax money for the workers.
Well, all economic expansion in the United States have been about 6 to 12 months offset from huge immigration influences. And so... I don't think we have enough Mexicans. They think we have too many.
Yeah.
So on any particular topic, there's a great deal of mixing of body fluids. But and so these are not really notions. These are sort of vague tent tops that you gather
ideas,
people under. And not everyone fits. You kind of get in the tent that comes closest. But on any
none,
particular
none
topic, it starts to... You can take... we could wipe out Republicans and make the whole Congress Democrats. How long do you think before they break into two factions and go into gridlock?
They probably already are.
6 to 8 days.
Yeah, that's right. they're not monolithic either. Yeah.
No, it's dynamics of a social organization of the human species.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you take a few guys who are passionate about an electric car as a solution, and they go build cars and drive them and demonstrate them to people, and they do this, this will continue up to the point of about 10. It looks like this huge mountain to convince 100% of the population. No, once you get to 10%, it's over.
That's it.
And that's what we saw on the internet. I sold my company in 1998. I couldn't even count how many people were online at that point.
Not at that point.
It had
no.
gone crazy.
Yeah.
And they were adding millions per day.
Yeah, the subscribers were going out of control. Yeah.
But yet I was there when there was 35 or 40 guys.
Mm-hmm.
You know, trying to beat the phone company out of a long distance charge.
How simple it all started.
I watched this progression, and it is a tipping point.
Mm-hmm.
And Rensselaer Polytechnic has actually received government funding to study this phenomenon and determine where it is and how it works.
How it works, yeah.
To be able to predict things like political revolutions.
Mm-hmm.
I'm more into technical revolutions.
Right.
And I think all of this with the oil can be solved for us in the United States by the widespread adoption of electric vehicles for our personal transportation. I don't care what you do with the railroads and the ships, if just the individuals would do the percentage of their miles that it works for.
Yeah.
In electric drive.
30 million and then
and
we
really
own.
The whole problem moves out a number of years, I believe.
Yeah, right.
If we got 20% of the population to drive electric cars for 20% of their miles, it eases the problem. But we'll never see that. That'll go by in a flash because it's going to be like crawling through 40 miles of piss, blood, and razor blades on your hands and knees to get to 10%, and to get from 10% to 90%.
It almost happens by itself at that point. Yeah.
You're going to have a strobe light and a high-speed camera to catch it going through 20%.
Yeah.
And then the final 10% is almost, it's like the adoption curve.
Yeah,
it's,
right.
You know, the, you, the last 10% of holdouts are going to hold out, and they'll be slow. So going from, we have to get it to the 10% mark, and at that point, it takes off. It's not as impossible a task as you believe. Your individual efforts in the hundreds of people to adopt electric cars, mm-hmm. buy a Leaf or a Volt even when it doesn't make a lick of sense, mm-hmm. or build your own electric car, yep. And drive it and demonstrate it, is unbelievably powerful statement because it affects the people around
right,
you.
Right.
And at the point where 10% of the population is convinced that now that gasoline's $9 an hour, we believe you, Jack.
Yeah, it got there.
Or Brandon Hollinger, or Dwayne Ball. Right. We believe you now. Yeah, right? At that point, it's a flash. Mm-hmm. And so while you're here's the irony, is it always feels like you're the only savage on the buffalo hunt.
Yeah.
You're in the garage, working, and here's your box of parts. You've waited 3.5 months for these parts, and they have half the right ones, half of somebody else's order.
Yeah.
And two key pieces that they don't know when they're going to get.
When they're going to get them at all. They're out at the planer.
And here you are. It does not feel like you're changing the world.
Right.
Actually, you are.
Yep, I think so.
Right there. Speaking of changing things, you ordered me some toys mm-hmm. in June.
Yeah, we did.
And we got them in this week.
We got them in a couple days ago, yep.
I have received some inquiries of a very interesting question.
Okay.
And it's actually answered somewhat online with various calculators. The answers tend to involve some rather involved integral calculus.
Mm-hmm. That was good.
And some formulas.
In school.
And I approve of all that, but how do you communicate it in a different way?
In a different way, yeah.
So I'm inspired to go drive the car.
We like driving electric cars.
And find out what the results are, and we'll make some changes and measure it again, and try to make this graphically comprehensible to humanoids.
Okay.
And a big part of it is some of the components that you received this week. Mm-hmm. Let's show me what you did to the Spyder.
All right, let's take a tour.
Net Gain Motors, home of the Warp, Transwarp, and Impulse Motors, introduced the improved Warp 9 motor. The Warp 9 is a 9.25 diameter series wound DC motor with a double-ended shaft featuring 26 improvements for 2010. Externally, the terminal studs have been enlarged from 3/8 to 1/2 inch diameter. Bigger is better. On the inside, a larger commutator, new brush composition, and split brush design with heavier springs handle even higher voltages and currents than before. Our new fan increases airflow by almost 50% over typical paddle-style fans. And all this translates into improved performance. For even more performance or larger applications, take a look at Net Gain's Warp 11 motor. An 11.75 diameter series wound DC motor for even greater torque and power. Since 2002, Net Gain Motors has been leading the EV industry with precision, performance, and price. Visit us at go-ev.com, Net Gain Motors, warp power to go.
Some of our more popular segments have been what I call watching paint dry, and that's some of our battery tests, which have to be the most boring videos ever created and placed on the internet. Oddly, our viewers seem to like them. I'm gonna attempt a new height in boredom with a whole whiteboard full of numbers and a discussion of range in an electric car. Discussions of range in an electric car must needs be, almost by definition, are all nonsense. And everything you've heard about range is essentially a lie. And there's a very good reason for that. The efficiencies that we gain in our drivetrain by using electric drive and the magnetic principle sort of translate into an inordinate sensitivity to the speeds and the way we drive. And so you can get any range you want with any car within certain parameters. To illustrate that, I'm going to jump to the end here. Speedster Part Duh was probably the best build we've ever done. The Mini Cooper is a more practical car with greater creature comforts. But I really like everything about the balance and scale and fit of Speedster Part Duh. Not the more powerful Redux, but the yellow one. If we drive that car at a steady speed of 40 miles per hour, our maximum range from 36 China Aviation Lithium Battery Company 180 amp hour cells comes out tested and not calculated so much as 157 statute miles as measured by a GPS. If we drive that same car at an absolutely steady state of 70 miles an hour, our range is 94 miles per charge. Now that's a 60% increase from 94 to 157. So we have a very wide range of ranges based on how we drive the car and what speed. And today we're going to talk a little bit about some of the factors that cause that and some things you can change on your car to get closer to this number than this number. And I have to point out that many of our viewers think they can't build as good a car as a Leaf. A Leaf uses a lithium manganese spinel battery that has a higher density than the lithium iron phosphate cells we do. But we can beat them in range with Speedster Duh rather handily. But even discussions of the Leaf, when they're talking about 100 miles, that's a rough approximation, and it will vary depending on how you drive the car and what your driving profile is. How all this got started was we bought Dwayne Ball's Spyder 550, and we've made some changes to it along the way. I didn't like the pot box accelerator. It felt like stepping on a pizza box. And so we upgraded that to a Hall Effect pedal. It's a beautiful build, but there are some issues. We also used that as a platform to compare the Curtis 1238-7501 controller, which has a top power level of 550 amps at 130 volts, theoretically, with their newer model 1238-7601 controller, which raises the current capability to 650 amp. And we published those dynamometer results. They were quite interesting. Something has bothered me about this car for some time, and we've kind of found out part of the cause, I think, and Brian ordered some parts. Dwayne wanted, quite accurately, to put on a lighter wheel than he had available. The Spyder came in what's called a wide five configuration that Porsche offered, but there aren't very many wheels that will fit that. And so Dwayne found some 911 wheels that look a little bit like Fuchs. They're not, but they're very pretty wheels, and put some 165 Kumho tires on it. But to do so, he had to place an adapter on the wheel. This made the wheel stand out about 3/4 of an inch to an inch from its natural position. This caused the wheel to rub on the fiberglass body of the car fender when he tried to turn the wheel. And the solution there was to put some coilover shocks and jack up the front end so it would clear. Well, this is not really how this car is supposed to sit. And every time I look at the car, it kind of bugs me. So Brian ordered some parts that we wanted to experiment with anyway from Aircooled that include a aluminum brake rotor and a Ford 5x4.5 wheel pattern. And that'll allow us to put some weld wheels and some low rolling resistance tires on it. But more importantly, it brings the wheel back in under the car. We can install some different shock absorbers and bring that front end down. Before we do all that, and we've had plenty of time since he ordered it in June, and we got part of the parts this last week, I thought we were going to have them all, I did some baseline testing of the Spyder 550 and Speedster Duh. And Speedster Duh, we hadn't tested it in some time, and it has a new set of Michelin Energy Saver all-season tires on it, and we hadn't really done any range testing on it since we put those tires on and had a front-end alignment on the car. And so I had been wanting to do it, so I thought, well, we'll baseline the Spyder and get our results, and then when we put on the new componentry, lower the front end, we'll go to a low rolling resistance tire and see what difference all that makes. But we'll also compare it to Speedster Duh. And so I've done some actual driving, quite a bit of driving actually, to come up with some numbers I think you're going to find kind of interesting if you're into this sort of thing. If you're not, you might want to skip this episode because it's a little dry. Let's talk a little bit about the two cars and what they have in common and what they have that's different. The Spyder has 36 China Aviation Lithium Battery Company batteries. They weigh 450 pounds. They produce about 120 volts and 180 amp hours. We have exactly the same set in Speedster Part Duh. The motor is a high-performance electric vehicle systems AC 550 three-phase electric motor that does offer regenerative braking and is, I've grown quite fond of this combination. For this size car, it's kind of bulletproof. I love this motor. They have two different controllers. The Spyder, as I said, we upgraded to the 7601, and the Speedster has, again, the Curtis 1238, but the 7501. I don't think that's going to contribute any difference in our testing because at these speeds and steady state, we're not going to go over a couple hundred amps anyway. So what the top amperage is shouldn't make much difference. One of the differences, talk about the 12 blind men around the elephant. Dwayne and I went round and round about this. We had changed the gearing on Speedster Part Duh. The ring and pinion is like the differential in the Volkswagen transmission to a 3.44 ratio because first and second gear were not of very much use. We went to that from the 3.88 ratio that the Spyder uses. Dwayne said, "Jack, you're crazy. I've got great use of all four gears with the 388. I said, "Dwayne, you can't. Without the 344, you don't have first and second gear." Well, I forgot that you also have a choice of gears in these transmissions. Incredibly, when I tested the car, it all became clear. His 388 and his gears, for example, at 40 miles an hour is 1600 RPM. Ours with the 3.44 at 40 miles an hour is also 1600 RPM. This is in fourth gear. At 50 miles an hour, his is 2,100, ours is 2,100. At 60, his is 2,600, I'm 2,500, and at 70, he's at 3,100, and I'm at 3,000. So they're very close to the same ratio in fourth gear, and in fact, the other gears line up similarly, despite having different differential ratios. And so that's, for the purposes of this test, kind of fortuitous. Some other differences is the Spyder is a lot lighter car. It's 1,903 pounds, and the Speedster is 2,035 pounds. This is without the driver, but with everything else on board. It's kind of interesting to note that the Speedster has 450 pounds of batteries, and so batteries make up 22.11% of the mass. In the case of the Spyder, the 450 pounds of the batteries make up 23.64% of the mass. And that lighter weight and increase in percentage of batteries should give this a longer range. As far as the frontal area of the car, the measurement of the total car plate pushing into the wind, they're both identical at 1.76 square meters. There is a thing, we're going to talk some more about this, called a coefficient of drag. They're not the same. The Spyder, every reference I can find lists it at 0.20, which is very good, by the way. And the new Tesla Model S will have a 0.27. The Volt is about 0.26. The Prius claims a 0.25, which GM contests and says that it's more like 0.28. But this is a coefficient of drag is double on the Speedster as it is on the Spyder. And that leads us to believe that we're going to have a lot better range with the Spyder than we do with the Speedster. Unfortunately, the reverse is true. The 40-mile range on the Spyder is 132 miles. It's 157 miles, or 18.9% more in the Speedster. The 70-mile-an-hour range is 86, and in the Speedster, it's 94, or 9.3%. And there's a clue there. Why do we have a different percentage difference at 40 than we do at 94? Let's cover some of the things that affect this, and let me talk about them one by one. In order for your car to move, you have to apply power and overcome some forces. The first one is inertia. The tendency of a body at rest is to remain at rest, which I do at every opportunity, and you have to apply a force to move it. Similarly, a body in motion tends to remain in motion. And that is essentially the law of inertia. This relates in the car to acceleration. If you're sitting still and you want to accelerate to 70 miles per hour, you have to apply some force to accelerate it and overcome this inertia. Understand that we, in order to take this out of our tests, what we did was basically have the drive at a steady state speed. In other words, we're not accelerating or not decelerating, we're maintaining the same speed. And what that does is pretty much take inertia out of our measurements. But your inertia will be directly related to the mass of the car. In this case, 1903 pounds, gravity times mass. And gravity times mass on the Speedster results in 2,035 pounds. But on this test, we really did not test that. and I still maintain that weight is a huge amount of your efficiency in your electric car, and the lighter you can get it, the better. For this series of tests, we didn't care about inertia. And so by maintaining a steady state speed, we eliminate that. Your second item is gravity. Of course, gravity is the force of the planet pulling on the car. It's the weak force, but it is substantial in this respect. And gravity will be exhibited when you're either climbing a hill or rolling down a hill. And rolling down a hill, of course, you use less energy and much more to climb the hill. What we did there was break our drive into two segments on essentially interstate highway, state highway in one case. And so half the distance was driven in one direction on some interstate highway that was relatively flat anyway, but all roads have some incline and some hills. And so we did half of it in one direction, got off at a exit and immediately back on and did it in the other direction, the other half. And so that should effectively cancel out gravity out of our test thing. We took gravity and inertia, which, and similarly, gravity is a function of mass. And so we've kind of tried to take mass out of it. That leaves two factors. The first is aerodynamic drag, and the second is rolling resistance. Of course, moving through the air, it's a fluid, and it resists our passage. And it resists it at various speeds. If you're going 5 miles an hour, you can hardly feel the effect of air. But if you're driving down the road 60 or 70 miles an hour, you can put your hand out the window and feel the effect of drag, try to push your arm backwards. Well, that's operating on the entire surface of the car as you're moving through this pool of fluid, air, and so that's a significant resistance and increases with speed. In fact, there's a formula for this. The force of drag, or the drag force, is equal to 1/2 PV squared CDA. And P is the density of the fluid, in this case air, and it varies slightly with temperature. For our purposes, not too much. That's not much of a factor, but it does vary with temperature, and that's what the P is. V is velocity, and that is our speed. And notice that it is the only square function in the equation. And so, as we increase our speed, the amount of power required to do that, to overcome aerodynamic drag, will be a square function, and that's pretty daunting. CD is this coefficient of drag that's really a function of the shape of the car and determined in wind tunnel tests. And A is the area, or the frontal area, of the car itself. And so the shape of the car and the frontal area of the car make a difference in how efficient it is going through the air. And its speed has by far the dominant effect on that efficiency. But you do have some effects from the density of the air, which is a function of temperature. These two cars, as I said, the Spyder has a CD of 0.2, where the Speedster has a CD of 0.4. I've seen that 0.39, but most authorities list it as 0.40. Not to be confused, if you're looking this up, with the other Porsche 356. This is the Speedster with the low windshield, but kind of a convertible without the top, which on the coupe diminished that number by giving a more laminar airflow. Our little convertible, when it comes over that windshield, there's a big backdraft cause there, and that's a problem. The best thing we could do aerodynamically for either one of these cars is put a hard top on them. And so that's the function. The next item is rolling resistance. And this resists our moving down the road. We think of it as kind of several things, but your drivetrain efficiencies, the resistances through the transmission, through the axles, the bearings that hold the car up have friction because of the weight of the car. Then your tires, after your drivetrain efficiencies, the tires themselves have a certain amount of friction going down the road. The sidewalls flex, and that generates heat, and they resist your going down the road. You've all felt a racing bicycle with a very narrow tire pumped up very hard, and how easily it rolls across a flat surface. Whereas a car, just to push it across the surface with the wider, softer tires, has much more resistance to that. And so that's what we're talking about with the tires. Of course, we've all been told that if we inflate our tires properly, we'll get better gas mileage. That's because they're stiffer and the friction's reduced when they're properly inflated. If they're underinflated, it hurts the mileage quite a bit. It can have an enormous effect on your gas mileage, or in our cases, efficiency. If you overinflate them, you do not have the same degree of effect. A lot of people are trying to pump their tires up to 50 or 60 pounds. It does not have the opposite effect of having them underinflated. And really, above about 45 or 50 pounds, you're not really doing very much. We typically run ours at 40 to 42 pound inflation on a tire that's normally recommended at 35 or 38. So we slightly overinflate them, but not a great deal. Now, what happened on the Spyder? We did our 40 miles. That took 21.2 amp hours to cover 15.6 miles. This was a piece of state highway up north of town they built to get out to our largest employer, Procter & Gamble. Very flat concrete. It has some hill to it. Again, we went both directions to come up with the 15.6 miles, but it has a speed limit of 45 miles an hour. Had I done 40 on the interstate highway, I'd probably be about this tall, smashed flat like a cat. The result was 21.2 amp hours, and that is an amp hour rate per mile of 1.3589. If I multiply this amp hour, which is our current at an hourly rate, the number of amp hours per mile is 1.3589. If I multiply that by my battery voltage, and I'm just nominally going to use 120, that's the worst case, it'll probably be some value slightly less than that, depending on state of charge and on the battery sag and the current load. But we're just going to take 120 as a constant because that'll give us our worst case watt hours per mile. And I see I'm using 163 watt hours per mile. If I take that amp hours per mile and divide it into the 180 I have in my battery pack, I get a maximum range of 132. 80% of that would be 106. And so this is really the maximum range we want to talk about in order to get maximum life from our batteries. You can run them to 100% discharge. You don't want to run them over that is the problem. And they will come, if they're properly bottom balanced, you can bring them right back up. And in fact, the life cycle tests that they did on the Kalb cells were actually to 100% is where they got the 2,000 cycle number that they use with 80%. It's a little fudge factor the Chinese build in, but it's kind of interesting the way they do that. But that's your maximum range at 40 miles an hour. When we go to 50 miles an hour, we had a little bit different track. I kind of entered at a stoplight each time to do the 50 and then went on to the interstate. And so it's 22.3 miles. That's 11.15 about each direction. And that was on a stretch of interstate highway at 50 miles an hour. And we were able to maintain a very stable 50 miles an hour and also know our mileage quite correctly because of the speedometer we put in the Spyder. One of our upgrades, mechanical VDO speedometer that came with the car had a cable that squeaks. Now, we all enjoy the silence of electric cars, but one of the things that brings up is any little noise that becomes quite annoying. And this speedometer cable squeak was driving me crazy every time I got in the car. We bought a new Speed Hut GPS-based speedometer, and that gives us an accurate miles on the stretch. We carefully duplicated the ride, and so I use those mileages with the Speedster because it still has a mechanical speedometer. But this GPS speedometer gives us a very accurate speed and a very accurate mileage. At 50 miles an hour, we used 32.8 amp hours. That's 1.4708 amp hours per mile. Times 120 volts is 176 watt hours per mile. And had we driven the car at a steady state of 50 miles an hour, we could go 122 miles to the max extent of our battery, or 98 miles observing the 80% buffer there. When we went to 60 miles an hour, our amp hours went up to 39.6. That's 1.744 amp hours per mile, 209 watt hours per mile, and our range drops to 103 maximum. When we go to 70 miles an hour, the same route, and exactly the same route on 60 and 70, we jump to 47.5 amp hours total consumption, or 2.0925 amp hours per mile, and that's a watt hour per mile of 251. At that rate, our battery pack is depleted at 86 miles. And so you can see the difference. At 70, we get 86 miles, and at 40, we get 132 miles from exactly the same car. Again, these are steady state speeds. Let's go over Speedster. Duh. The same 15.6 miles, the same RPM, I point out, 1600. We used 17.9 amp hours instead of 21.2. This is in a heavier car with twice the coefficient of drag. But we got a significant reduction in the number of amp hours. In fact, 18.9% reduction. It's a 1.1473 amp hours per mile. That's 138 watt hours per mile instead of 163, and a maximum range of 157 miles as opposed to 132. That's a 25 mile difference in range. This is shaping up to be a puzzle. When we go to 50 miles an hour, We jump up to 29.3 amp hours, but again, that compares very favorably to the 32.8 done in the Spyder. That's a 1.3139 amp hours per mile, 158 watt hours per mile, and that would give us a range of 137 miles. I'm liking the better all the time. At 60 miles an hour, the same distance, we use 36.3 amp hours as opposed to 39.6 in the Spyder. That's an amp hour per mile, 1.5991, 192 watt hours per mile, and 113 mile range. Feel like Don McNeely giving the weather in 1963. He had a little squeak pen and would mark the temperatures for us all around the area. 70 miles an hour. I'm at 3,000 RPM instead of 3,100. Same mileage. I use 43.4 amp hours in Speedster Part D and 47.5 in the Spyder. That's a 1.9118 amp hour per mile rate, or 229 watt hours per mile, worst case. Something less than that, actually. A 94 mile range. The duh in every single drive in every direction and at all speeds was significantly more efficient than the Spyder, which is 132 pounds lighter and has a coefficient of drag of 0.20 instead of 0.40. How can this be? There's a clue in here somewhere. And the clue is, at 40 miles an hour, we have an 18.9% difference in efficiency. At 70 miles an hour, that difference in efficiency drops in half, while our amp hour rate more than doubles. What does that mean? It means that aerodynamic drag is not actually our problem. We know by the book that the CD is worse in the Speedster than it is in the Spyder, and that they have the same frontal area, and we're using the same speed, and we have the same density. The 1/2 is a constant, and so our drag force should not be substantially improved in the Speedster over the Spyder. In fact, it should be worse. And if we take aerodynamic drag out of the problem, we're left with rolling resistance. Now, there is an aerodynamic drag component that could be part of this, and that's the front end of the Spyder jacked up. If we could lower it and get it to its proper place, we may not be at 0.20 with it jacked up in front. So that may be part of it. But I would say that the majority of it has to do with the tires. Now, they're inflated to the same level, but this is a 165 60 R15, and this is a 185 65 R15, but this is a Michelin Energy Saver all-season tire. They're not actually not available right now. We've got a set on the Speedster Duh, and we got a set for the Cobra, and now they tell us they are out of stock nationwide. We're going to put a set of Bridgestone EP100s, Ecopias, on the Spyder, and that should give us a partial cure and get us more in line with Duh. And we're going to take a look at the drivetrain a little bit. we're going to install some ceramic bearings in the drivetrain. We're going to go to those tires. We're going to inflate them. They're already properly inflated. And we're going to drop that front end and see if we can account for some of this. But when I see 18.9% difference at 40 miles an hour and 9.3% difference at 70, I'm thinking aerodynamics is not it. It's in rolling resistance, and that's what we need to attack. If we can get some savings in weight while we're doing it, our inertia and gravity segments will also improve, but we haven't really tested for those. So we've got kind of a mystery here. Why does Speedster Duck get so much, and it's really quite dramatic, better efficiency than the Spyder? And we're going to attack that with tires, some drivetrain components. There is some noises from the back of the Spyder, and we haven't really isolated what they are. But, for example, if you drove with the parking brake on for some distance and overheated a rotor and it was out of flat, we might be dragging a brake pad or something along that nature. We've checked the handbrake and we don't seem to be dragging, a handbrake. But something like that's what I'm looking for. So in the process, we're going to replace all the rotors, all the calipers, all the pads, put in new bearings, and so forth, and hope to get better at this. I'm not going to be able to complete this talk this week because we have to install the components and retest the Spyder. As far as the controller, one thing I did forget to mention was I did have to go back and set the Speedster regen to five. It's called neutral braking by Curtis to 5% with a 500 RPM taper to match the Spyder's, and so we don't think there's anything in the controller causing this. But right now we've got an open question: why is the Speedster so much more efficient than the Spyder when it's a heavier car with a worse coefficient of drag? And unfortunately, in the world of real testing, rather than typing to each other what you think it probably is, you can get that pretty neatly wrapped up by simply everyone voting and agreeing on something. In the real world, you often get test data that is anomalous, and right now, I don't have a full explanation for why this is. We're going to have to continue to investigate it. And our component changes may account for some of it, but may not take it all out. And we'll have to work that over the coming months. We have a lot of questions around here that kind of continue for months or years. Eventually, we usually bird dog them to the ground with an aha moment, which is kind of why I do this. I like those so well. But right now, we've got a puzzle here that is fairly important. I thought I would share some of our test methodology and the numbers so you can see what some of the components are, really most of the components of efficiency in an electric car, and how that results in your ultimate range of the car. There are some online calculators where you can enter your coefficient of drag in your frontal area and your rolling resistance. The problem is that all those inputs are guesses, and so in a lot of cases, and so the outcome is too. Particularly when you get into rolling resistance, it's you can do a coast down test, you can do some other things, but it's a little problematical to get the inputs into that calculator to get a proper output. I prefer actual tests of the car on a road with a driver and a result, and then correlate back from that. So I don't put much stock in the online calculators. But this is a little bit of the numbers and the measured elements that we'll use to kind of get at the heart, really, of a problem, and not so much problem as a question. Both cars drive fine. Both are getting better range than I need. However, it's annoying to me that this is this way when it shouldn't be, and I'd like to find out why. Let's take a look at what Brain's got going in the garage as far as how to get there from here.
This episode of EVTV is brought to you by the Winston Battery Company Limited, makers of high-capacity lithium-yttrium rare earth cells, including the popular 160-amp-hour model featuring cycle lives in excess of 5,000 cycles when discharged to 70%, the longest useful working life of any available battery of any chemistry. A leading battery technology scientist, inventor, and entrepreneur since 1995, Mr. Winston Chung envisions a new world of clean electric power for the dawn of a new era of electric vehicles. For your next electric vehicle design project, contact Winston Battery Limited. Energy for a bright future.
Okay, Brain, we're taking a little break and doing some Spyder stuff. The day before yesterday, we weighed it. 1,903 pounds.
1,903 right? pounds for the Spyder, yeah.
Yesterday, I went and did some kind of extensive testing of the amp hour consumption.
Okay.
At 40, 50, 60, and 70 miles per hour. This will be kind of interesting. Now we're going to do a couple of things. We're going to remove these wheels, which, as it turns out, is a very lightweight wheel. We're not going to gain much there.
Get these couple off of here.
Yeah,
while we're there.
Pull that off and let's show them our problem.
Yeah. Yeah, and these are alloy wheels, which we haven't felt them yet. They should be light, but it's hard to tell. Mm-hmm. Let's see what we got here. They're not too bad.
That's about to take off on you. Those would be very good.
Yeah.
The problem is not the wheel, although the tire is a Kumho. We have a delightful adapter plate here.
Yeah.
And we have a really heavy steel rotor.
Mm-hmm.
And this is, what do you call this, that they come with the wide five?
This is the wide five. So it not only has the disc here, but it's also got a separate, so that we can get a wide bolt pattern. As you can see, it's almost as wide as the disc is itself.
That's actually an option from special editions, but it is how the original 55 mm-hmm. Spyder was, wasn't
it? Yeah, it is, yes.
The wide five. So this came with the wide five. So Dwayne wanted 911 wheels or something.
He did. He got
And he's got some good wheels.
He's got nice wheels.
I don't like the tires too much. So he puts this adapter, and it stands that out. What do you think? An inch?
Probably an inch or even a little more, yeah. It's on both sides.
Right. And then on the front of the car, what that causes is wheels to rub on the body.
Yeah, when it's too low, and we need to lower this car a little.
So he's got the front jacked up.
Mm-hmm.
We have ordered and should receive tomorrow some air-cooled rotors that should be some lighter. We're going to find out exactly how much lighter
mm-hmm.
than what we have here. We're going to lose the adapter.
Right.
And we've got some welds that we're going to put on that'll be as good as these, and I like the look a little better.
Mm-hmm. It's a nice looking wheel.
And some Bridgestone.
Yeah, the Ecopia
EP100s,
yeah.
Low rolling resistance tires.
Yes.
That's kind of just barely in the ratings behind the number one Goodyear Michelin.
Right.
Energy Saver AS.
Yeah.
And that's what I wanted. What happened?
They're not available. They have completely sold out of the, at least in our size, at least the 185 or even the 195, 65, 15s. and there aren't going to be any more until they do another production run. So across the country,
at a local store,
Sears, all over the country, including the Michelin warehouse.
The Volt and the Prius now use a Goodyear tire. I can't remember the name of it now that I'm
Is this
standing.
A Max something or other? I can't remember
Fuel
the name.
Max.
Fuel Max or something like that, yeah.
And it's not near the low rolling resistance. What else are we going to do back here?
Well, we're going to have to retain the stock caliper because we're going to go to the Wilwood, the aluminum calipers. They don't have any that are provisioned for an emergency brake. They're racing calipers.
And you kind of have to have a parking brake on
them. Yeah, there's nothing that we can do with that. So we'll end up retaining this, the rear caliper. The front, when we get to that, we'll be able to put on the aluminum calipers, mm-hmm. along with the rotors. And we're going to take this all apart because we also got some new bearings to try on the axle.
Bearings.
We got some new bearings.
Let's take a look.
Yeah, let me get those bearings for you, Jack. And we've got first a stock bearing, which is...
Now, these bearings hold the whole weight of the car, right?
They do. They're holding the out... These bearings are out here on the outside, on the outboard side.
Of the axle.
Of the axle, precisely.
And this is a ball bearing with... what do we got here? 3/8 big balls. And... I guess our axle's on the inside and our wheel's on the out, and it spins. And I can spin, it'll go a couple, three times around. And that's a steel ball bearing, stock one each. Price, $12.95.
Probably about
$12.
I think that's a 6306 bearing.
6306. And this one is not even a hybrid. This is a 100%. Silicon nitride,
yeah.
Ceramic bearing that spins much more freely,
mm-hmm.
and with a lot less friction than the steel bearing. Cost on this?
What, $24.95?
I think they were $325 each.
All right, and we got...
From Ortec.
Got two of them.
We have two of them, but we're going to try them. The Illuminati guys say that's the tits.
Okay, we'll try them.
And so we're going to try these, number one, ceramic bearings. Ceramics come in three different versions, really four.
Yeah.
One is a hybrid where the outer parts are steel still, but they have a very round, very hard ceramic ball.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's simply much rounder. That's called the hybrid bearing.
Okay.
Then they have a full ceramic. They're usually kind of a terracotta colored or flesh colored.
Okay.
And they are a full bearing, and that's this, all of it is, and they're very good in high heat situations.
Oh, okay. Okay.
And they're much lower friction. And then this is kind of the highest quality. This is a silicon, I want to say carbide, and it's not. It's a silicon nitride.
Nitride, okay.
Ceramic bearing, and that's the black balls and so forth, but also this and this. So what are we going to do? This is kind of a target of opportunity. We got these bearings a month or two ago. Since we're changing the brakes and the wheels, we're going to pop them on here, and it's... kind of non-trivial. We got to take that axle apart, like when we did the rework.
We're
going
to have to go all the way inboard and pull the axles out,
mm-hmm.
and hopefully be able to get those fulcrum plates back in.
Yeah, and then we've got to go turn them in and get them pressed.
Yeah, I don't want to take a chance with these. They need to be pressed. I don't think we.
You know, I've got a 3-pound sled.
I know, but I hit it, so.
Okay.
I think
I can get them on there.
Think you can find it?
And I think I can get them on there. No, if you show me where the hammer is.
That's right.
Okay. Well, let's get started stripping this down. The main what's the main mission here on the car? Our real driver is to lose the adapter. I'm sorry, Dwayne. That was not a good solution.
Yeah, we're gonna have to go away from the wide fives, and I think we did a Ford pattern on the weld wheels. Yeah.
5 by 4.5 or something.
Yeah,
like that.
Something like
4
that.
4 by 5.5.
Yeah, I think 5 by 4.5.
And so that's going to get us into a Ford wheel. That'll open up the world for us.
Right.
But we're going to use a weld wheel,
mm-hmm.
and a Bridgestone Ecopia tire. But the big thing is lose the adapter, lower the front end. Now, we've been talking about aluminum framed speedster.
Mm-hmm.
And so because we need to do this, we contacted Aircooled and talked to them about their aluminum rotor and aluminum hat, which they sell separately. You can do this
right.
in any
kind
combination.
Right, kind of mix and match, yeah, right? Yeah.
It's a very flexible system.
Yeah.
And these are cross-drilled aluminum
yeah,
rotors.
Yeah, I think they're cross-drilled aluminum rotors, yeah.
And that's going to be quite a bit lighter than what we've got here. Of course, we lose the adapter. And then we can put our weld wheel with a fork
exactly.
pattern on there. That is a precursor to if we did do an aluminum framed speedster, we would equip it with an aluminum rotor.
Oh yeah, we'd want to use that running gear. That's some light stuff.
Now, what's the problem with aluminum rotors?
I'm sure they have steel inserts. They probably have a cast iron insert.
I bet not.
You don't think so? And they'll wear faster.
Well, they would if we'd use them.
Yeah, that's right.
But how do we stop in this car?
Yeah, we usually just can use a little bit of our regen.
Right.
Yeah.
And so this is a racing type product that's probably not appropriate for a street car because of durability. You're going to be changing your rotors when you change tires.
Yeah, quite a bit.
However, in our case, on this particular car, and not true of all of them, you know, when we have the net gains,
we don't have any regen, right?
And in fact, redux, this would be a terrible idea. It's a heavier car.
Yep.
And then with no regen, we'd be mashing.
We'd be using the brakes a lot.
The brakes. But on the Spyder, 1,903 pounds, hopefully going down.
Yeah, hopefully going down 18-something, yeah.
Maybe. And with the high-performance electric vehicle systems, AC 50 and the Curtis. This one has the 650.
This one has the 650. Yeah, they've seen the test that we did on the dyno back a few months ago.
Well, we're going to back that up this time, and we're going a different direction to some range test. I want to show what rolling resistance does and what air resistance does.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we'll lower that front
end.
And
so yesterday I did a series of tests, about 20 miles a lap.
Okay.
And I'd go down the road and then back the road so there's no incline function.
Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah. It's all zeroed, canceled out.
It's zeroed out.
Yeah.
And counting amp hours per mile at different speeds. And that'll give us our air resistance component. Now we're going to change these bearings and lighten our unsprung weight at the same time.
And low rolling resistance tires.
And go to a low rolling resistance tire.
Yeah.
We're doing so much. And I'm not
we won't
sure
be able
we're
to tell,
going to be able to tell
able
which
tell
parts matter.
That's right. Well, I guess we'll know overall.
But we will. I think it's going to be a huge upgrade in a lot of ways. Not at 70 miles an hour, but at 40.
At 40, yeah.
And so you'll be able to tell the impact of air resistance and why almost every range discussion you've heard about an electric car, including a lot of mine, are essentially nonsense. I'm going to show you why. Some Leaf owners have plenty of range, and others just don't get
it.
Well, there's a reason.
Yeah.
and we're going to show that.
Okay, cool.
But we're going to try to improve this one somewhat with some lighter weight rolling stock as an experiment pointing toward an aluminum frame car.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And we're going to fix our little problem in the front by losing this delightful Dwayne Ball Scott Smith special adapter plate.
And that'll pull that front track, all this track in about 3 inches total, and get that front end in underneath the lip.
I think even our air resistance might change a little bit.
I should be able to lower the car down a little. Yeah.
Because we're pretty smooth underneath.
Yeah, it actually is. It's got a. It's pretty
smoother
cool.
Smoother than the Speedster.
Much, much smoother. They've got that little cowling under there.
Uh-huh. And so. That's what we're fighting is weight and air resistance, and this is kind of the program. I'm going to leave it to Brain to show you the ugly step by step because it requires a lot of threading and unthreading of bolts, and he'll be able to do it much faster if I don't help.
If he doesn't help. No cross-threading allowed.
No cross-threading. I'm not going to get between him and a nut on this particular project.
So just as bad as a squirrel.
Just as bad.
So what I'm going to end up doing first is this 36 millimeter nut has come out of here. It's got a, this really is your axle nut that holds your either your brake drum or your rotor on. Before we disconnect the brakes, we're going to go ahead and take this off, and because we really need to have someone in the car holding the brakes down, we'll never get this nut off.
All right, air wrench to do this, but it didn't work, so we're just going to go ahead and use the old trusty here and knock this thing off, because there is, I think this calls for maybe 300 foot-pounds, maybe a little more of torque, so.
Oh, shit.
Step on the brakes. Can you pump the brakes a couple times? Okay, got it?
Yeah, go. There, it's coming.
Okay, that's what it takes, the persuader. And we'll do the same on the other side. Okay, so what we're going to do now is take off the emergency brake cable. Now that we've got these loose, we don't need the brakes anymore. We're going to go ahead and we're going to leave, since we're not changing this caliper, we're going to go ahead and leave these hooked up, because we don't want to have to bleed the rears anyway. We'll have to bleed the fronts when we take those off. And we're going to go ahead and disconnect the emergency brakes. At this point, with just with this little knurled nut, sometimes they're a little swage, but we lost that in Carlisle. Had to go to the auto parts store and get us one. So I'm just going to unscrew this, and that will allow us to get this e-brake cable out of there. And we've also got a little clip here, a circlip. Yeah, we're going to see if we can get a hold of and pull back in here. And this is going to be tough for any of you to see no matter what, but you just take a screwdriver, kind of grab the clip on the closed side, pull it out, and then let it go to the floor. But that will get us, and looks like they've got things tied together here. Let's cut the little zip tie without cutting the brake line. Not a good idea, actually. But, and that will free our emergency brake cable. And there we go. Okay, what we're going to do now to take this caliper off, there's two 17 millimeter bolts back here. And we are just going to go ahead and loosen them up. They should be on here pretty good. If I go the right direction. Okay. Those will get our caliper off the rotor, and like I said, we're not going to take off the brake line in the back, because we're not going to be replacing this. Okay, there's some little. If you notice, those flew out of there. Those are shims, two on each side, and they're actually between the. They hold the pad of the housing of the caliper off of the rotor. So when you take stuff like this off, you may see one of these little washers fly out of there. It's not on the back of the bolt. It's in between the bracket and the caliper housing, and that sets it off so that your caliper housing is not rubbing on your rotor. So those you need. And there's our rotor. Excuse me, our caliper. We're just going to put it up there right now, and we don't have to mess with the brake lines on this one. We can go ahead and pull this off, get a hold of it, and we should be able to drop that, pull this entire rotor assembly off of here in some fashion. And we don't know what we're going to be using of this again, so there we go. So that's our rotor with our adapter plate, and that's what it looks like from the side. There's the rotor, and there's what allows us to do that wide five. As you can see, that would, you'd have to bolt it onto the rotor surface. That doesn't work. This bracket will come off. This was the bracket that with the caliper was on. We're going to take this off next. We're going to drain the transmission next. We're going to show you, I think, how we do that. And we're going to lift the car a little bit. And you've all seen this if you've seen any other episodes. I think this is a 17 millimeter hex key. You don't have them very often, call for them, but you have to have one if you're going to work on anything that's VW based. So we're going to go ahead and lift the car up now and drain the transmission fluid. All right, so what we're going to do now is go ahead and drain the gear oil out of this thing. So again, 17 millimeter hex key, which a lot of people won't have, but you need one if you want to be doing this kind of stuff on Volkswagens. And it's a good idea if you like your glove dry to just let your hand get it at this point. And we're just going to go ahead and drain all this out. And that is about as exciting as I can make that. All right, so now we're going to go ahead and begin to pull this apart. And as we spoke earlier, we're going to put in one of these ceramic bearings that's on the outboard right here. To do all that, though, we've got to get all this apart and get to the bearing. So first step is to, it takes a 36 millimeter, and this is a castellated bolt, and it's castellated to take out the cotter pin. I've already done that. It's not too pretty. The best way to get a cotter pin out is to just bend these, and you can either, there are pullers that are kind of curved and have a little point. I don't use those. I just use a set of dikes, and I'll just grab it and keep running it. You can see all the marks on it, and I just keep pulling it out till it finally pops out. This is a 36 millimeter bolt right here. It goes to, I think, 220 foot-pounds of torque. So it takes a couple of people, one to sit inside usually and hold it, and another one to take, like I use a long metal pipe, like a piece of gas line. It's 6 feet long, to torque that off. We'll go ahead and pull that in a second. In the meantime, we're going to pull the caliper. They're 17 millimeter bolts. There's two of them back here. And you just kind of feel your way around. Okay, there's that one. And let's see if there's any of these little washers back here. Yep, okay, so there's a washer too. And what that does is when you put this back together, and we're gonna be putting this back together with another kit anyway, and we'll show you that. You wanna make sure that you have spacers, and what that does is that sets the body of the caliper so that it doesn't dig into the rotor. In fact, I was talking to somebody yesterday, a fella came to visit us that had a Myers Toad, and he was driving it from Washington to Atlanta, and he was saying that when the guy put his brakes on, replaced his pads, that they took the caliper off, forgot to put that spacer in there, and it ground out his rotor. He had to take it back to the fella, so they're not too happy when that happens. Got another one on this side. They're pretty tight. And this is another thing we want to test with this car is we may have either a warped rotor or a brake that's dragging a little bit, and it might be this one from the way it feels. Now I'm leaving the emergency brake on there and the line. I'm probably going to end up changing those, though. We're going to get new calipers with our rotor kit from Aircooled. So I think I'm going to change all of that too, and we'll just go ahead and Because like I said, we don't know. We might have a caliper that's sticking, e-brake. They've sent us, we're gonna get a new caliper. We're gonna be waiting for the brackets. But we've got a new e-brake. So I'm gonna go ahead and put that in, a new e-brake cable. And we're just gonna start with brand new brakes in the back because we're not quite sure if that's been affecting our range in this car. So we'll just go ahead and pull this off. Okay, that's off. There's that other spacer. All right, so we've got all of our bolts here for the caliper and our spacers. So we've got that out. Now we're gonna go ahead and take these are 14 millimeter bolts. We're gonna go ahead and take those out, and that will get us to our bearing. When you take this apart, you know, just look at it. If you have a VW book, it's good. It's always good to get the Bentley manual. I kind of like that one. But, you know, parts in the kits change over time. And normally they'll give you a bunch of parts in that little kit. And you don't use them all because they're going to be for a 1949 to 1968, I guess. Type 1 swing axle before they went to IRS, and some type 2s. So they just put all the parts in there that you may or may not need because it's just easier for them to put them all in there. But so it's just a good idea when you take it apart to look at where everything is. And we have drained the transmission already and have put the bolt back in, and we also put a little note on the door. As soon as we get the car down from the rack, I'm going to put it on the right on the Speedo glass or whatever, or on the steering wheel, that tells us that we have in fact not put in the oil. Once we put in the oil, the gear oil, and we got ourselves some 7590 Valvoline. We've used Redline, we've used Royal Purple, we've used quite a few different ones. This one should give us a little less friction than a petroleum-based 8090, but we kind of like running it. It sometimes you can get a few leaks, extra little leaks, because it's just so thin and slippery. I don't know if that's a wives' tale or not, but I don't know. I'm kind of believing that. But on an electric car, it's nice to have things as friction-free as possible. Now we're going to take this bearing cap off, and that's why we put this drip pan here, just to get any extra out of there. And you can see there's a little, and we'll replace all these, there's a little O-ring in there, there's a little spacer in here, and you want to pay attention to that. One side is beveled, and that's the side that goes in toward the axle. You're using all these angles and things to try to deflect as much of the gear oil back. It's got a little spacer here, and it's also got an oil seal. So just pay attention when these things come apart. You'll see the same thing here. You'll see a little O-ring that goes on the on this side of the bearing, and it fits right in there. You see on that little concave area. So all these things just kind of fit together, and just pay attention to how these things come apart, and it should be easier. And that is our bearing. And now if you look at that bearing, same thing. You've got a flat surface here that goes against the bearing, and you've got again a little beveled area that goes against the axle itself. So that bearing is out, and we're going to head and pull. Well, we're going to leave that in there because we're probably going to need it. What we're going to do, since we haven't seen our other parts, as far as our we're going to have a new bracket for our caliper. The brackets always point back. The caliper always mounts a little behind the bearing housing here. So this always goes in this direction like this. But we're gonna have another one anyway. We just wanna clean all those parts. As you can see, there's a little bit of silicon on here. I don't tend to use a lot of silicone on here. I think silicone is, I can't remember what band said that, but silicone is for toys. So we don't use too much silicone. We might use some red sealant or something on that. The bearing, we're gonna put it on in this direction with the balls facing in because we've got the we've got this in there. So we've got our little spacer here, which again, our little concave went right there. Spacer goes on there, and we pop this on like this. And this is going to probably need to be drifted in there. And you can kind of see that this axle, once this spacer's on there, it sits right in there real nice. I've got a hammer here, so we're gonna go ahead and just kind of gently drive this through. We're just using a piece of actually plastic pipe. This one happens to have an insert in it, just a threaded insert. It's actually a little stiffer than PVC. And we're just gonna go ahead and drive this thing in here. Drive it just a little more. All right. And then what we're going to do, clean all these parts, put them back in the order that they were in, and go ahead and button this all up. Yeah, but we've got to wait for this bracket before we put a final in here. So we'll bring you up to speed on that. Masterflux proudly presents the Sierra Series brushless DC variable speed electric compressors. The Masterflux family of compressors are up to 40% smaller and lighter than competing belt-driven DC automotive compressors. Masterflux uses rare earth neodymium magnets for longer life and greater efficiency. The robust rotary design is ideally suited for rugged EV applications. With a scroll type compressor, the process begins with the refrigerant entering the evaporator from the suction side. Refrigerant then travels through a reed valve to the top of the compressor, where it is compressed at up to 8 times the incoming pressure before exiting out the discharge tube to the condenser. Masterflux compressors are available in 400 to 15,000 BTU per hour capacity range for multiple refrigerants, including 134A. Output can be manually adjusted using a simple 0 to 5 volt pot. Masterflux compressors are available to handle input voltages of 12 to 420 volts DC and come with a specific BLDC motor controller for each voltage range. The new Masterflux 2011 product catalog can be downloaded from their website at www.masterflux.com. Masterflux products are available in the US from Revolt Customer Electric Vehicles, in Australia from EV Works, and in South Asia from EV World. Masterflux, the technically elegant choice for powerful electric air conditioning.
All righty, Brain.
Hey, here we are in the shop.
So, I've kind of told them about the problem. Our Spyder is not as efficient as I think it ought to be.
That's what you were telling me, yeah.
And you've got the new bearings installed.
We've got the new bearings installed. Yeah, the ceramic bearings are in and ready to go.
That's a ceramic. I don't know really. I've seen it as silicon nitride and silicon carbide.
Okay.
So I've said it both ways. It's probably a silicon carbide bearing. What was the bearing number? Do you remember?
6306.
6306.
Yeah.
And we got that from Ortec. They were $325 mm-hmm. bucks a side.
Yeah.
Instead of, but that should do a little bit for our
drivetrain resistance.
Yeah, they seem to roll really nice, at least by hand.
Another thing we're going to do for the drivetrain resistance, I saw over here that you've got our little note about gear oil.
Yeah, that's a big deal. You always want to put gear oil in. Anytime you take an oil out of an engine, we don't have to worry about that, at least with these cars, or a transmission.
A little reminder put it
back in, yes.
We took out the gear oil that was in the transmission. It was pretty heavy stuff.
It was the regular 80-90 petroleum base.
Kind of a chocolate syrup type thing?
Yeah.
With a little maple in it?
A little maple, yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yep,
80-90. That tastes good.
Yeah, it's great on pancakes.
But it slows down your car. What are we going to put back in, buddy?
We're just going to use a Valvoline, just a full synthetic 7590. So it's a full synthetic base. 75 is better than 80. And it also should, you know, it makes the transmission a tiny bit noisier. But I think that it's, you know, we've got it in duh. We've got it in Redux.
Yeah, it's worked real well.
Yeah, so we're going this way.
This actually makes a bit of difference. You do hear the gear noise.
You hear just a little more gear meshing, yeah.
But it really cuts the losses through that transmission.
Yeah, and this is about $12 a quart versus, you know, like 6 or 7 for the other. But I think you only use 3.5 quarts or so in this transmission. It's worth the extra $20 to do.
So that's about what we can do about our drivetrain losses.
Right.
Is pretty much go to a lightweight synthetic oil, and we're putting in a ceramic.
And some bearings where we can get them. Yeah.
The bearings, you know, one of the neat features about them, which doesn't really matter to us, but just for your edification, a stainless steel bearing will start to lose its shape about 573 degrees Fahrenheit.
Okay.
These are good to 1800 degrees.
Okay, all right.
And so you do build up some heat in there.
Yeah, yeah.
And so they'll last longer and stay rounder longer.
A lot longer, okay.
But is it worth $625
yeah,
difference?
Yeah, versus some $10, $12 bearings, yeah.
Yeah, we're kind of digging pretty deep here. I want to try it to see what it does, but I would say that would be an unusual car that I would want to go to that expense for what you would get in a difference in rolling resistance or drivetrain resistance there. So that brings us to kind of weight and rolling resistance. Weight really isn't a factor. Too much in the tests I did, that comes into play for acceleration, and you like that.
I like acceleration
too.
So he's
we're going to take off what weight we can, but the big thing is, of course, rolling resistance.
Yes.
But we want to play with these new parts. We got some from Air Cooled
out in Arizona.
Arizona.
Yes.
They're not Chinese.
They try hard, but...
I don't think they try. They're real nice.
They're very nice, yeah.
But they don't try hard. They're in Arizona working half days. You ordered those when?
Well, prior to July 7th by maybe a couple of weeks. I don't have that date, but the invoice date
late
was July
June.
7th, late June, yeah.
He invoiced us July the 7th.
Yeah.
We got the parts when?
Yesterday.
August
18th.
Yeah, I can get them on a slow boat from China in 2 weeks.
on a custom cruiser.
And they send me all the parts I ordered, which I'm never sure they even know what I'm trying to buy. The email translation is difficult. I never know if they know what I want, but I always get pretty much what I ordered.
Yeah.
Sometimes that turns out not to be what I want, but it was what
I
ordered.
It was what you ordered, that's right. It's like,
what happened with the wheel one?
We got rear hubs for a long axle, and we have a short axle. So they were either pulled incorrectly, I'm not even sure.
You think that half of the parts were for somebody else's order?
I think so. We get these, the brackets, which we don't know what they look like. I'm going to have to take both of these sides apart again, probably, to put the brackets to mount the calipers. Now, we did get new calipers with this kit. They are the same calipers that we have, and they are a little heavy. They're the MP style calipers. but we can't get the Woolwood aluminum calipers without they're not provisioned for an emergency brake, and we've got to have an emergency brake.
One of the things about this car, Brain, I've always thought we were dragging a brake.
There was something back there, that little noise that would...
There was a little noise at low speed that always made me suspicious. Now, it went away as soon as you were rolling.
Yeah, it went away as soon as you were rolling, maybe because it spread the pads out or something, but there was either a warped rotor or something back there could have been an issue.
Might have been a warped rotor. He may have driven it around with a
sticky caliper
brake on it or something.
Yeah.
Anyway, we're going to replace the caliper that's on there.
Yeah, we got it. We're going to take this one off and put the same MP5 caliper.
It's the same one, so we can do the parking brake. And we're going to do a little work on the parking brake cables.
Right here, we're going to put new parking brakes in since we've got it. This is where we attach it up to the handbrake. Mm-hmm. So I'm just going to go through, while we got it stripped down like this, to hopefully alleviate this issue back here, we're just going to replace all the parts. So we'll have new brake pads here. We'll have a new parking brake, new caliper, new rotor. So we should be sitting pretty.
All right, let's talk about the front then. Now, recall, and he's still got this on here so you can see this. They had a pretty nice wheel. It's not a Fuchs, as it turns out.
No, I think it's a replica.
A replica of a Fuchs.
Yeah.
But they were pretty light.
They're very
light. And they had a pretty narrow Kumho.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, 165.
A 165.
Yeah.
I had been doing the... 165s to get the rolling resistance down before we started playing with the actual low rolling resistance.
Yeah,
this is the adapter that we've talked about being on here. So this is a wide five, which is actually the traditional configuration
for this car. Yeah, it's correct for this vehicle, a wide five VW pattern.
We're not really too concerned about correct.
No.
It's not 1955. I need that efficiency to go up. Mm-hmm. We should be getting a lot more than 100 miles on this car. It's light, and it's just not right. Because this was on here, the wheel is spaced out. What do you say, 3/4 of an inch?
Or more. Maybe, the way I calculated was, at least an inch, maybe over an inch.
If you had it properly set up in the front, it rubs on the body.
Yeah, if we can get that, inch back on each side.
So what they did to get around that was put some very nice coilover shocks on the front, which isn't very heavy anyway.
No.
And jack the front way up in the air. And now our coefficient of drag is probably not as advertised.
No, it's like flying, when you first take off the DC-3 before you get the tail up. You're kind of looking at the sky.
So we're wanting to replace that shock with a...
We're going to do the KYB, the GR2, which is their, a very nice workable gas shock, which is really all we need in the front. The front's being held up by the torsion bars in the axle tubes, and we've got an adjustable front end with this car. Mm-hmm. So when we'll still have this thing up, we'll go ahead and crank this front end down an inch or two, and those shocks don't have any coil springs, so they're not able to support the front end weight. They're merely for rebound, just for dampening.
Of course, working with some other guy's car, and I love Dwayne. He is coming to the show and bringing the 904.
Yeah, it's gonna be cool.
Is that you find out stuff when we got under here to replace rotors, what did we find?
Well, one of the ways to do this wide five disc brake conversion kit is to do it with the the drum brake spindles, which are different. The hole positions are maybe an inch bigger than on the later model VW Beetle and Carmen Ghia disc brake knuckles, the spindle here.
So your bottom line is we're not going to finish this week, are we?
Nope, I won't be able to get the parts till Monday.
So we got to get the disc brake spindle to go on here to work properly with the disc brakes.
Yeah.
Now, this is the air-cooled And it seems like a very solid unit. But they've got, aside from that they can't get the right parts in the box, and they didn't send us all the parts.
They didn't send us all the caliper brackets.
And then we have to go back and get some more parts anyway.
And we have to go back and send them the brackets and get some more parts. That one is not his fault. But I'll...
Okay, so that's our fault.
So at least we got one out.
We're Americans, too. I'm telling you, the Chinese are going to hire the Brazilians. They're not going to take us.
That's right. We're not going to even get in the line.
Well, we've got a comedy of errors here that's going to cause a little delay for a week. But this is a beautiful piece of work. It's a billet aluminum hat, and it's made separately from the rotor, which is an aluminum that's cross-drilled and anodized, not terribly thick, about the size
about
of the steel
size of
one.
This. Yeah, yeah.
And so this is some weight savings, but it's also, they can put any, what would you call that normally on a rotor?
It
would be
pattern.
A hat.
Yeah, well, this hat, and then what he does is he puts any bolt pattern on here for your wheels.
Right. So he can make the rotor separately, and then the hat is anything you want it to be.
Basically, yeah. This, and we actually got I think this may be the first Ford bolt pattern that he's done.
Is that right?
In this, yeah, because that's why we had to send the rotors back, was not only because they were wrong, the width of the axle, but also I think this is the only set he's ever made.
So we got a Ford 5x4x5.
Yes.
Is that right?
I think that's what the Ford pattern is.
Yeah. And that's the thing. Well, let's stick these on the scale and see if we gained anything. Got us a new scale for parts. This weighs 14.8 pounds for our hat and our rotor.
Let's see what the other one weighs, huh?
What do you got on the other one?
That's a little tubby.
23.7. Well, that's not quite as much as Kerry indicated I might save, but what have we got there? 14.8 and 23.7.
So what, 7.9 pounds? Right.
Nine point nine pounds.
That's
times four.
40 pounds all the way around.
Is 40 pounds.
Yeah, that's not bad.
Yeah, I'll take it.
Yep, that's not bad.
Now on the front here, we don't have a parking brake.
No.
This is our regular caliper.
Yeah, and it really takes this. We're gonna have to. We're still going to have a bracket, but it won't be nearly this big.
Oh, it won't?
No, not at all. Because we got that little tiny caliper. We'll have a little piece right here is all we'll have. So 9.9 pounds for that.
Okay. And what's this weigh? This is a Wilwood aluminum caliper, and it just doesn't weigh a thing.
It doesn't weigh a thing. No, there's just a single-sided caliper. So I can't imagine this is what, more pound and a half, 2 pounds, yeah.
Yeah, 2.1, 2.2 pounds. Well, that's...
So that's 7.5 pounds, 8 pounds almost. On
okay,
these two,
so we're at 18 pounds per wheel.
Uh-huh. Yeah, that's not bad. Well, the front ones. The rear one's still using the old calipers.
Okay.
Yeah, but that's still not bad. And this is weight that's moving around a lot, too, up here.
Mm-hmm. The that is one of the issues. They refer to this as unsprung weight.
Yeah.
Here's your springs. Your car kind of floats on that. This takes all the road bounce.
Mm-hmm.
Your rotor and your hat and your brakes and your wheel and your tire.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the closer we can get that down, the less mass it has. The less shock transmits into the car.
It should ride smoother and should handle quite a bit better. I can't wait to see how it handles on the autocross course.
So what did we save on the?
We saved the 7.5, 8 pounds.
8 pounds and 9.9.
9.9, yeah.
So 18.
18 in the front, and 10 and 10 in the back. So that's what, 36 in the front, 56 pounds.
Well, let's focus on the front here. We're at 18.8. Let's weigh the tires. This is the Fuchs replica with a Kumho.
a 165 tire on it. And it's pretty light, I think. I think Wayne did a pretty good job with that. And that's 31.1 pounds.
Yep. And there's the weld.
This is the weld with a Bridgestone Ecopia EP100 tire.
So a pound and a half.
Well, we were 31 and a half and 29 and a half. That's two pounds.
2 pounds, yeah.
So we're going to save 20 pounds per wheel.
On each axle up front, yeah.
Up front and 12 in the back.
Yeah.
That's 64 pounds all the way around of unsprung wheel weight.
Right.
That should make the car work a little better. Now, once you have that on, you can change out this shock and bring the front end down, mm-hmm. improve our aerodynamic thing. And that gets us to the tires, which right now is my main theory as to the difference, is that that Speedster Duh has the Michelin Energy Saver mm-hmm. all-season tire on it.
Yeah.
Would you believe you cannot buy those anywhere in the country?
No, you can't. I've tried everywhere, including talking to Michelin. They just do not have them in the United States right now.
There are no Michelin.
Yeah, the Energy Savers. Yeah.
In a 185-65.
That's right, at least in a 185-65. And 195 I tried.
Right.
Yeah. Nothing in a 15, apparently.
This is a nice light weld wheel. Now, on the tires, on the ratings, this Bridgestone Ecopia is just under, comes in just under what you see on the
Michelin Energy Saver.
And I mean, it's pretty close.
Okay, so this should be a nice tire.
It's
looks good.
It's going to be very close to the same rolling resistance.
Mm-hmm.
But I have to tell you, I could warm up to this tire, and here's why. These are $100 a piece now.
Oh, okay.
The Michelins are $125.
Okay, so that's $100 on a set of four, yeah.
It is $100 cheaper to go with the Bridgestone Ecopia.
Yeah. And if they're, you know,
and
if,
and
rated
and, I
almost
mean,
the
they're
same.
Down to just almost the same rating. There's a whole article on rolling resistance, actually several of them,
mm-hmm.
At that Tire Rack website.
Yeah, they've got some good
they've
reviews.
They've got some pretty good information
yeah.
on
yep.
it. And Consumer Reports has done some stuff on this, and this Bridgestone Ecopia, which they claim has great wet weather handling, and in all the reviews they say not.
Oh, really? Okay.
Uh-huh. But
so the Michelin's a little better in wet weather?
Right.
Okay.
And the rolling resistance is kind of a function of this tread material and your sidewall. As you flex and go down the road, that there's some loss there.
Mm-hmm.
And
okay.
these tires are a big, and we're going to see just how much. I mean, unfortunately, I'm throwing everything up against the wall, so it's not a very pure test.
We won't know really what works.
We're not just changing the tires.
Yeah, we changed
but,
it all.
But cumulatively, we should get some gain mm-hmm. From doing this. But this Bridgestone tire is available. The Michelin's, for some reason, until they make another
until
batch.
Until they do another production run.
Another
yeah.
production run.
Yeah.
They're sold out nationwide. Now, both of these tires are much better even than what they put on the production cars. The Volt is using the Goodyear fuel saver.
Oh, the fuel max or fuel saver.
Yeah, fuel max.
Okay.
And that's supposed to be a pretty good tire, but the Bridgestone and the Michelin, Bridgestone Ecopia
that's
and
what,
the Michelin.
Yeah. The Energy Saver.
Energy
AS,
Saver.
Yeah.
Are both much better
okay.
on rolling resistance than the Goodyear tire.
Okay, good, cool.
And so we're going to try this. I have to tell you, I know that design is famous on the 911, but I really like the look of your weld wheels.
Aren't these nice wheels? Yeah, these are really nice wheels.
And they are a little bit lighter because, mm-hmm. you know, this tire is wider. This is a 185 instead of a 165. You know, this tire is heavier.
Yeah, a little bit.
And so, but we net out 2 pounds lighter going to this wheel.
All over, yeah.
And with a better rolling resistance tire.
Yep, nice.
And so that should get us home to some degree, and to summarize, we're going to decrease our drivetrain resistance or losses with right. the lighter weight oil and the bearings,
right?
Our aerodynamics should improve by dropping the front end.
Yeah, that's right.
Which is actually where all this started.
Yeah, we shouldn't catch so much air. Yeah.
We actually did change the shocks earlier mm-hmm. and found the wheel rubbing and sort of in a forensic expedition, figured out what they had done and why.
Right, and that, yeah, it was because of kicking out. And the thing that would have just fixed this was to not go to the Porsche-style wheels, just for them to use the regular wide five mm-hmm. wheels, and you can get some light ones in that. So it was just really wheel choice and having to add mm-hmm. quite a bit of weight up there.
So we did have that option of just going, but the wide five wheels are hard to find.
They're hard to find, and they're very
and they're kind of pricey.
They're pricey. I mean, to get a set of aluminum wide five wheels, since there's only the guy who used to make them isn't even making them anymore, and they're kind of a design off of a Tecno Magnesio, an Italian wheel, but they're all aluminum now. Mm-hmm. The guy used to be a machinist for Boyd Coddington, who makes real nice custom wheels, and they're about. Maybe
$1,000 a piece.
Yeah, about $1,000 a piece. Probably $100.
One
set on
that,
Samba
that
right now.
That leaves us a little room. Our air cooled whole pack with the Wilwood and the whole thing.
Everything they're seeing up here was about
$1,800.
Yeah.
So, and we went to $100 tire.
Mm-hmm.
And so I wanted to play with the air-cooled mm-hmm. system because it is lighter. We don't need a really stout rotor in this light of a car. We'll be probably just over 1,800 pounds.
Yeah, in fact, one of the changes that we're making, which is to go to steel lines, mm-hmm. you know, out from the regular brake lines, will mm-hmm. give us a more solid feel on the brake too, because that the rubber will swell a tiny bit before you when you depress it.
Mm-hmm.
So this should actually stiffen up the brakes with just that.
I don't like rubber lines anyway.
Yeah, if they burst yeah. or anything, yeah, they're terrible.
And so we'll go to the steel lines, but actually in the car, this one and the Duh have the high performance electric vehicle mm-hmm. system, mm-hmm. AC50. And we slow it down and do most of the braking with the motor.
With the motor, yeah, through the regen.
Our rotors, if you notice, are rusty.
Use them much.
because we just don't use the brakes that much. So durability of rotor, which we're going to sacrifice some going mm-hmm. an aluminum mm-hmm. rotor.
Yeah.
It's not like a steel rotor.
Yeah, but we
as
should
far
be
as
okay.
wear and life and, yeah. and so forth. But... And they use it typically in racing applications where they don't care how long it lasts. But in our case, the weight reduction is significant.
It's a big deal.
And in the case of this particular electric car, which features regenerative braking, we don't even care about the brakes. We just
Not
have
that
to
much.
Have them.
We just have to have them. Yeah, to get it registered.
To get it registered and really to park it.
Park
you have
it.
To have the parking
brake. Yep.
And so you get into some odd things there. We'll try to get these improvements mm-hmm. incorporated next week, and we'll be able to post our results
yep.
On the whole thing.
Yeah, let you know what we find.
All righty. Let's get back to the chalk talk.
Back to the board. Back to the cool studio. Or uh-huh. meaning cool.
Back out of commission. That's one thing that's happened to it.
Yeah.
It's making
it's
progress.
It's very efficient sitting still.
Oh man, it's just it doesn't use a lick of energy at all. It just well, I guess going up and down on the rack.
We can't finish the show this week because we can't complete the car. But now you've got the setup,
mm-hmm.
A comparison of the two cars. And their energy usage, we're going to finish the Spyder hopefully next week.
Yeah, we should have the parts Monday.
And then we're going to test both cars just mm-hmm. to make certain. a gang.
Yeah.
And see if
we'll
we can
get at those graphs.
See if anything moves.
Yeah, exactly. That'll be fun. That'll be really
and,
good.
And I cannot explain the disparity between and the Spyder. If it makes that much difference, the little changes we're making, it would surprise me, but it would point that little differences make a big difference.
Yeah, especially cumulative, yeah.
And so we want that installed, and that front end lowered, and schedule us for an alignment.
Yeah, we need an alignment too, yeah.
Just in case that has something to do with it, because these are actually profoundly disturbing numbers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're the Spyder should be performing better.
It should.
And, it's lighter.
Wouldn't you think?
Yeah, I would think. Yeah. Same power plant.
Have I miscounted the batteries?
They're the same.
They're the same batteries, same number of them,
same motor. The controller, we got the 650 amp in duh, but I mean, that's a, I mean, not in duh, but in, yeah, in duh. But
it, we never went over we, yeah, 200
we went
amps.
Over. Yeah, we never went over it.
So we never went over 200 amperes.
No, that's what I mean. So that isn't going to make a difference. It's it could have been something mechanical. We don't know. We had a little suspicion of maybe a brake rub or something, but that was an awful lot of energy to be robbed from a brake rub, if that was the case.
Well, now that can do it.
Yeah. So that's why we're going to put all new calipers all the way around, even though we don't have to, new pads.
New rotors.
No rotors. Change the brake cables out, shocks in the front, lower it, and new lightweight rotors in the front, wheels, tires that are low rolling resistance. We'll just have to see. I mean, man, it should really perform well after, be my guess, but we won't know till we do the test.
I think we've got some interesting things coming up. We'll see what happens next week.
Mm-hmm.
And then we're going to isolate part of it because we have the Cobra coming up.
Mm-hmm.
And on the Cobra, I have two sets of wheels and tires.
Yeah, we've got the ones that came with in the low rolling resistance.
And we have the Michelins on the new wheels for the Cobra.
Yeah.
And so we should be able to do the test in the Cobra, jack that puppy up, swap the wheels out, and do it again
and
determine what percentage of all this is just low rolling resistance tires. Okay, Brian.
I think we kind of nailed it. Hopefully everybody's still awake. Yeah, I think that's a show.
Is that a couple hours?
Yeah, probably.
I'm Jack Rickard for EVTV.
And I'm Brian Noto.
We'll see you all next week.